Okay, great. I see that everyone's on board now. So please let me start by obviously thanking the Africa Fair Trade Convention for organizing this and for inviting the Fair Trade Advocacy Office to moderate this important webinar. And thanking all the staff of the convention for the very hard logistics to make all this possible. My name is Jorge Conesa. I work at the FTAO, the Fair Trade Advocacy Office, which is an organization that catalyzes collaboration within the international fair trade movement on policy, advocacy, and campaigning. Fair trade trains and supports farmers to become organic farmers, close to half of all fair trade farmers are also farming organically. So obviously organic farming is key for all of us, but the importance of organics go beyond that. There is a clear market trend toward organic productions, toward consumption of organic products in the EU. So organic is interesting not only for those who have already switched to organic, but actually for all the farmers who might be interested in benefiting from this market trend in the future. So before we start, let me do some housekeeping. Firstly, and very importantly, this conference is being interpreted to various languages. On the down part of your screen, you have an icon, interpretation, where you can switch to English, French, Spanish, Arabic. So please feel free to select the language that you feel most comfortable with. Secondly, you can also see that there is a question and answer function. Please feel free to use it during the presentations, because we are first going to have 10-minute presentations by the panelists, but then we have saved quite enough time to answer the questions that we will have. So please keep on asking questions, and I will allocate time at the end of the meeting to answer them. Then this event is being web streamed, and we are using hashtags for communication. So if you want to communicate about this, please use the hashtags Africa Fair Trade Convention, or Producers Led, or Fair Trade Africa. I will post them in the chat box. Well, never mind. So that's about it for housekeeping. Virginia, are you able to share your screen with the presentation? Brilliant. So we have four great panelists with us today. We're going to first hear from Elena Panici from DG Agri, Morag Webb from Cole SCP, Escipión Olivera from the ACP organization, and Michel Renaud from IFOAM Organics Europe. So the first block of this webinar will be dedicated to understanding what is the evolution of organics in the EU, and why did the EU need to review this legislation. For that, we are very honored to have Elena Panici, who is head of unit of the unit on organics of the European Commission's Director General on Agriculture and Rural Development. Elena, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you. Can you hear me? I hope so.
Perfectly.
Yeah, okay, but I don't see the presentation now. Okay, let me make... Okay, wait a sec, there's a problem. Zoom. Voila, there we go. So good afternoon, yes, to everybody. My name is Elena Panichi, and I'm the head of unit of organics in DG Agriculture and Rural Development in the European Commission. I'm going to give you a presentation, an overview on the organic sector in the EU. It's and to really to focus on the importance that the sector has nowadays at European level, a bit of a glance on what are the trends for the imports into the EU, and I will conclude with the topic of this conference, which is the new organic regulation, why and what is going to change. Please, the next slide. As you can see, with an increase of more than 63% of the share of surfaces in the last 10 years, organic can definitely be considered one of the most dynamic sector in the panorama of European agriculture. The European Union accounts for almost 14 million hectares of organic, and these are mainly concentrated in five countries, which Spain is the first one in terms of surfaces, with more than 2 million hectares cultivated as organic, followed by France and Italy. Overall, at surface level, organic farming occupies now the 8.5% of the total EU farmland. That means that from a niche market, it's moving, I would not even say that slowly, but steadily towards really being a solid share of the European agriculture. As you can see from the picture there, every country is represented. So that means that if we have a share of 8.5% at European level, there are quite some big differences among the member states. And as you can see, Austria, for instance, has more than 25% of land occupied by organics. But you have also, which is, I would say, the best example we have in Europe, together with Estonia and Sweden, but then we have also countries which lag behind with lower surfaces, like 3-4% of their land to organics. So there is still, I would say, a pretty long way to go. The next slide. From the market value, the organic retail sale in 2019 worth almost 40 billion euros in the EU27, and the European Union is the second largest single market after the US, and followed by China, which is increasingly at a very fast pace. From when we analyze country by country, we see that Germany is the first market with 12 billion euros, followed by France, 11 billion euros, and Italy, which is at 3.6 billion euros. Also, there are very big differences, as you can see, in the value of the organic sector in the different countries, but also differences in the spending per capita. So we have Denmark, where 344 euros are spent per capita per year in organics, while this is, I would say, the highest level, and you have also countries in which there are few euros spent in organics, and the average stands at around 84 euros per year. And when talking about the relative weight of organics into the grocery basket, Denmark spends 12.1% of the grocery is organic, followed by Sweden, around 9%, and Austria as well, 9%. We can move to the next slide. Imports is an important chapter of the organic world. You can move to the next one. As you can see, what are the countries which are supplying European countries with products? First of all, we have Ecuador, followed by Dominican Republic and China, respectively 12%, 9%, and 8%. And you can see also the variations to compare to the previous year. And you can see that Ecuador has increased substantially its exports to the EU and Dominican Republic as well, while exports from China shrink, probably mostly due to new path of, well, it's 2020, so that means that is affected probably by the sanitary contingencies we have been going through in last year. Ukraine is the fourth country. And if we move to the next one, we can see also the kind of products that we are importing from those third countries. So overall, we import 30% of tropical fruits, nuts and spices, 8% of oil cakes, and 7% of cereals, excluding wheat and rice. So this is just to give you an overall view of what is organic and what is the importance of the relation that the European Union has with third countries in organics. Can we move to the next one? The new organic regulation, so the regulation 2018-848, will enter into application as from next year, 1st of January 2022. We can move on. Next slide. What is why a reform and what is the added value? Why reform? Because the sector is growing. In the current regulation, which will be valid until the end of the year, there were provisions that were mutated from the previous one. So we are talking about provisions that were going back to 1991, so the first regulation, and where nobody could really expect such an increase, such a popular, such a development of the organic sector. And therefore, there was really the need to harmonize the rules and really streamline all the regulation in a way that to create a level playing field for the operators. So in fact, the added value of the reform is, first of all, harmonization. There is a, we put an end to the a la carte derogation, what we call. So derogations which were given on a case-by-case situation to create a level playing field for organic producers within the EU and vis-a-vis third countries with the introduction of the compliance, as I will explain better later. Substantial simplification also will be brought in the new regulation, in particular for what the group certification is concerned. And in particular, this is a novelty for European producers, which we mutated from the third countries indeed, which were already authorized to use group certification, but under guidelines. And now it has been introduced as a piece of legislation into the new organic regulation. And it's an advantage for small producers to reduce certification costs and administrative burden. And also we shift a bit more on the risk-based controls, aiming to reduce the administrative burden to the operators. We can move to the next one. There will be also new opportunities with, for instance, new products which are introduced into the scope. There are rules on animals that were not contemplated until now, so cervids, rabbits, insects, and the introduction of the possibility to commercialize what we call the organic heterogeneous material. So seeds, genetic material, which is characterized by high variety, genetic variety, which can better adapt to a situation, different, I would say, climatic and edaphic situations. And clarification, but this is rather, I would say, related to the European sector, because we put in phase the official control regulation to with the organic regulation to create a more harmonized approach in the sector of the control to get to a robust control system with clearer rules. We can move to the next one. What are the novelties at stake in the future for what the international trade regime is concerned? We can move to the next one. So as I said, introduction of the compliance to the European rules, that means that as from next year, after a 3 years of transitionary period, third countries operators will have to apply the same rules as those which are set out for the European producers. That was a very controversial proposal. It brought a lot of discussion around that, but I can assure you that we did all the due analysis on that, and when we prepared the proposal and when we had an impact assessment of the proposal, we saw that the differences for the sector which are the most important, like the plant products and in particular, so as you could see, it's we import mainly tropical fruits, oil seeds and so on. For the plant products, the main differences that were spotted between the current standards applied by the control bodies in third countries and the new standards are very limited to certain derogations that so we don't expect any specific disruption of the trade. There will, of course, be certain possibilities foreseen in the use of the substances, because we acknowledge that there are differences in the, I would say, in the pathogenic in the pathogens that can hit one cultivation, which is not in the same climatic condition as Europe. And these substances will have to be, of course, in line with the EU legislation. So the basic regulation, I would say the list of the substances will be the same in the EU and in third countries, but there will always be the possibility to ask for inclusion of new substances when there is a need for pathogens that are not present in the EU. As I said, no substantial changes for the plant production sector. It's true that the new regulation brings some more changes for what is related, for instance, more to the livestock sector, the processing sector, but for the plant production, the situation will remain pretty stable. And it's a novelty for the European Union. I said not a novelty for third countries, the introduction of the group certification as a part of the regulation. We really saw that this the group certification was working very well in third countries in terms of really giving a possibility to operators to reduce, to get together, to reduce the burden of certification, to reduce the cost. And that's why we also introduced it for European operators. It's true that we had to shape it a bit, because until now, I would say, being in guidelines, there were no real strict rule on that, and we could see that we acknowledge the importance of such a group of operators, but we needed to streamline in order not to get to these examples of a group of operators made up of 80,000 operators, which for whatever internal control system, good control system you can put in place, 80,000 is totally an example, probably, I'm sure, an extreme example, but these examples exist in which there is really no control. And the success, we have to bear in mind that the success of organics relies on the confidence that the European consumers put on the products. And we really have to strive that the consumer confidence is kept high with a proper control system. Where are we now? We are in the phase of finalizing the secondary legislation. So all the acts either have been already published, in particular those which are related to the production rules, to the control rules, they are all published. We are finalizing now the acts which are rather is operating in third countries, and but in any case, they have been all published for the feedback mechanism and for the TBT, and we had the possibility to comment them and to reply to queries which were presented by the third countries on this. Then, just if you go, I will click quickly go through the last slides to present the action plan. You might have heard about this. This is a part of the farm to fork strategy. I mean, the farm to fork strategy sets a target of 25% of organic land in 2030. So as you could see at the beginning of my presentation, we are at the level of 8.5. We aim at getting at 25%. So it's really a challenge we have in front of us, and the target is ambitious, but we have put in place all the elements to get to this sector. It was adopted on the 25th of March. We can move to the next slide. And it's based on a set of actions, which also in, well, you can move to the next one, which is easier to explain. It's organized on three axes. So the first axis, we really focus on stimulating the demand and ensure consumer trust. We consider that without a stimulation of the demand, so without an increase of the demand of organic products, and as you could see at the very beginning, there are huge differences among member states. So from 344 euros to a few euros per capita per year, if we don't stimulate the demand, farmers will not be stimulated to convert to organic. So it's very important that we promote the EU logo, promote the use of organic in the canteens, increase the use of public procurement, and continue building the consumer trust. Second axis, you can move to the next one, is what we call on the way to 2030. So we will put in place all the measures to stimulate conversion and reinforce the entire value chain. It's very important that all the money that will be allocated by the member states in the frame of our common agricultural policy are really paying attention to organics and its need on the territory. Moreover, we will also create instruments to really get to know the market as much as possible, because in this way there we could have indications for the farmers how to convert and if to convert is to the organic sector. And to conclude also, third axis is the leading by example. We consider that organics is, can really be a model for other kind of agriculture. It can poise as an alternative to conventional agriculture. But still, also in that case, we can still convert, contribute to improve the sustainability of organics and leading the sustainability of other agricultures. In this way, we will invest money in research to improve yields, to improve the use of the substances, and also to try to lower the impact in the use of plastic, water and energy. So this is all from my side now. I don't know if the moderator wants me to take already the questions or you let first the other panelists speak.
Thanks a lot, Elena. So yes, indeed, we already have some questions regarding some surprise regarding the relatively few African organic exports to the EU, and some questions about the information about that. But I'm going to leave those questions for the end. And right now, now that we have the framework and understand the rationale behind this regulation, moving down to what are the impacts that this regulation will have on farmers from African, Caribbean, and Pacific countries. And to deepen on that, we have with us Maura Güell, who is head of science and policy at COLE-ACP. She's expert on market access, sustainability, food safety, and plant health. And she oversees the research and innovation activities, guides sustainability strategy of COLE-ACP, and provides technical advice. She also engages with regulators and standard settlers on behalf of ACP horticultural sector. And she has worked very closely with the FTAO in this file. So please, Morag, it would be great if you can guide us through the aspect of this legislation that require us to pay more attention from the ACP perspective.
Hey. Morning or afternoon, everybody. It's a pleasure to be joining you today and to be contributing to this very important session. Next slide, please. I'll be talking to you today on behalf of COLE-ACP. We're a private sector association, and so you know my perspective today really will be from the private sector. Our members are producers and exporters in Africa, Caribbean, Pacific countries, and also EU importers. We provide services to our members, but we also implement technical assistance programs that are funded by donors to support the fruit and vegetable sector. So next slide, please. So while we work across the board with fruit and vegetables, we work in conventional production as well as organic. We're working in 49 countries. We have over 700 projects. Many of these are working with MSMEs, exporting and producing fruit and veg. And we've seen a big trend towards organic production over the last 20 years and organic exports, particularly to the EU. One of the questions I saw in the chat earlier was, why are there no exports from Africa? Well, there are lots of exports of organic products from Africa, but the tables that you saw earlier were looked at were based on volume, and they're not always high volume products. I mean, that, you know, we see the very large exports of banana from Ecuador and Dominican Republic, which obviously push their volumes up, but there are lots of exports from Africa. And we find that now around one in four of our customized support projects for MSMEs, producer groups, etc., include some organic related activities, including support for conversion, certification, etc. The next slide, please. Because of this, you know, our role as supporters and providers of technical assistance, we've been following very closely the EU organic reform because we recognise that it is going to have a big impact on our constituency. It's been a long story, as the previous speaker mentioned, launched in 2004, still ongoing, but the new rules will all come into force in January of 2022. We've heard why change, too old, too many grey areas, etc. But also there were very strong feelings amongst EU operators that some of the existing rules favoured third country suppliers. This is a sort of difficult discussion to have because, you know, keeping a level playing field as the new EU organic reform rolls out will be very, very important. It's taken a long time in terms of you know, the reform of a regulation such as this, and that reflects the wide variety of views and positions and some really contentious issues. And it's important to recognise that some of those contentious issues remain today. But the outcome after this, you know, these 7 years or so of discussion and negotiation, and as it's been mentioned already, a lot of consultation with the public, there is a new regulation that will come into force. And there are some important changes with implications for suppliers outside of the EU. And these accompany these major policy initiatives. So the next slide, please. We just heard about the farm to fork. It's a major strategy for reform within the EU towards reducing environmental and climate footprints, and also with this ambition to support a global transition towards more sustainable agri-food systems, which we all recognize are essential in the current environment that we are living in. As we've already heard, the aim is the target is to have 25% of EU agricultural land under organic farming by 2030. This is going to create some real opportunities as well as challenges. There'll be a big push to increase consumption and demand, which could and exports to the EU. But it's also important to mention that, you know, that the enabling environment within the EU will be really focusing on supporting production in the EU, support to farmers, support to boost sustainable practices, and also a legal framework that's supporting this shift to organic. And this enabling environment may not be present in all third countries that are exporting to the EU. So it's important to recognize that there may be some disparities here. And also something really important to mention is the retailer position. A lot of organic produce has really evolved over the last 20 years from being a sort of niche product that's sold in relatively small outlets to being something that's much more mainstream and now an important component of any supermarket, you know, availability of produce and provision of produce to buyers. what tends to happen within a sort of supermarket environment is that when something's been around for a while, it's no longer so niche. And so it, you know, it becomes more mainstream and it tends to often lose its price premium. And we all know that in the organic sector, it costs more to produce things, and it will always cost more to produce things than conventional because you are obliged to adopt certain production practices. And it's getting very difficult now in some sectors, for example, banana, to keep offering this organic supply, but when you're not any longer getting the price premium. So I think it's important to sort of recognize that there are things going on also in the commercial environment that are creating some big challenges for organic producers. So next slide, please. See them, you know, focusing on the Africa, Caribbean, Pacific fruit and veg export sector and the main changes that, that we see that will affect our constituency. So the next slide, please. First of all, one of the really important things to bear in mind or to understand about this new regulation is that it has a real shift in the sort of philosophy behind it. We're moving from a philosophy of equivalence to one of conformity. What does that mean? Well, at the present time, under the current system, we have this equivalence concept, which means that organic goods can be produced in different ways. It doesn't really matter as long as the way that the things that you're using are aligned with organic principles, and also the outcome is equivalent. It can be, you know, accepting of different ways, different substances, different production systems, etc. And also there are two ways that you can be certified. This can either be against a national organic standard that's equivalent, and that means it has organic rules that are recognized and accepted to be equivalent to those in the EU, or you can be certified by a control body that the EU recognizes as equivalent. In future, that's going to change. The equivalence concept will no longer be applicable. We're moving to this system of conformity where all producers, whether they're in Europe or outside of Europe, they all have to conform with exactly the same set of rules. So that brings in really quite a big change in the way that the new regulation will function. So next slide, please. First of all, there'll have to be a shift in, you know, in the trade rules that we've already seen now that's come through in the secondary legislation that's already been mentioned. We have at the moment equivalence agreements with third of their national organic systems. These will have to be renegotiated as bilateral trade agreements by 2026. This is creating some questions about how it will actually work. When you have a bilateral trade agreement, the negotiations tend to be not in the public domain, so they're not particularly transparent. And the content of these bilateral trade agreements will not necessarily be that available either. So there's a real challenge here to ensure that you have parity and fairness between countries that have and that don't have a trade agreement. So, if, for example, if you're growing pineapple in Costa Rica, which is one of the countries that currently has an equivalence agreement, or you're producing pineapple in Togo, will they be produced on the same terms? Secondly, equivalent control bodies, the certification bodies, will become authorized control bodies, and there'll be an EC list of these control bodies that are recognized, both EU and non-EU, and they will be authorized to carry out inspections and certifications outside the EU, but always now against the EU rules. So you won't have a system, for those of you who are joining us today, who are producers, you'll know that you'll be certified and that your certification body will have a sort of list, for example, of substances and conditions that are particular to them. That will no longer be the case. You will be certified against the EU rules only. And that will, well, there's a 3-year transition period for that to come into place by December 2024. So there is some possibility of losing the flexibility that you have at the moment to adapt to the local conditions. Next slide, please. Border procedures, very quickly here, the secondary legislation is that has already been mentioned is now on. Some changes here are important to highlight. There may be a change from customs points to border control points, which could mean stricter controls, and it may limit the number of entry ports that are available to bring organic produce into the EU. The organic certificate and also the organic certificate of inspection will be subject to some changes, and the details on, for example, who will issue them are at the moment out for consultation. The timing of the issuance of the certificate of organic inspection, which has been a challenge for all of us over the last couple of years, I think that essentially the conditions and the 10 days, et cetera, will remain. So there are potentially some challenges there still. Next slide, please. Now the control rules, I'll go through those quickly because I know that one of the later speakers from ICOS, this is going to be where there are some big changes affecting exporters of fruit and vegetables, but not only, also for other particularly plant-based production systems. Group certification was brought for farmers in developing countries enter organic value chains and become part of sort of global providers and providers of the EU market. At the moment, only farmers in developing countries can form groups. And these groups can be certified in one of two ways. They can either be cooperatives, farmer cooperatives, et cetera, that are organized as farmer groups, and they can act themselves as the legal entity, or you can have processor trader managed groups where the exporter or the trader sets up and manages a group of affiliated farmers and the we find that this is the predominant group at the moment. It's enabled small farmers who do not necessarily have the facility to take on all of this admin responsibility have been able to instead rely on their trader to do that for them. In future, this is going to change. As has already been mentioned by the previous speaker, groups can now be formed from in any country, including in the EU. So it's not going to be only the preserve of developing countries. A big change is that group members must be farmers. So the processors, exporter, trader managed groups will no longer be accepted as certifiable entities for the management of farmer groups. That's a really big change. Each of these groups must have their own, must be a legal entity. They'll have to register as a legal entity. They'll have to operate their own joint marketing system, etc. And they also will have to implement their own internal control system, though they can nominate a person or body responsible. That's going to require some big changes. And as COLACP is a technical assistance program, we recognize that many producers and producer groups are going to need help in order to achieve that. Also, an important point to mention is the maximum size of the group, which is, you know, currently does not have a restriction, will be limited to 2,000 members. There also are some other potential limits to the scale that I know that one of the next speakers is going to go into in more detail. These changes are going to be important. The time scale for transition, we know that for the change in group size is going to be 3 years. It's not specified in the legislation whether this change from the trader manager group will last 3 years, but we're very much hoping so. There will be rules about sampling that have changed. We're moving from the square root system to have a specification that a minimum of 5% of members and not less than 10 must be inspected every year. Smaller groups of less than 10 must be inspected every year anyway. And there will be a requirement to have produce sampling and analysis of 2%. That will be, you'll hear more about that later. Also in terms of the organic certificate, the format has changed and some aspects will need to be addressed, such as the fact that all members in futures must be listed on the organic certificate. Next slide, please. So this is my last slide. Holding status, if we look now at production rules, that one thing important to mention is that holding status might change. It's clear in the regulation that now entire holdings must be managed as organic, except under certain conditions. This recognises that there have been certain problems with trying to ensure organic status when you have some operations that are organic and some are not. But it's not clear from the regulation itself whether that is only for the EU, because it only mentions within the Union, or whether that also applies to third countries. Authorisation of products and substances, that has been mentioned, and it is one of the issues that we feel is going to be particularly problematic, particularly in the fruit and vegetable sector. There is a new implementing regulation and associated annexes that are currently under consultation that actually list the substances that can be used in future in organic production systems. Only substances listed in the annex can be used, unlike now when you can you've got your CB lists within each country. And very important to bear in mind is that only substances that are authorised for use in the EU itself can appear on that list. And the uses must be limited to those that are approved under the EU conditions for use. And as has already been mentioned, that creates some challenges where you have pests or production systems that are different to the EU. Because of that, provision has been made to allow the authorization of additional products. Sorry, excuse me. But it's not really clear at the moment how that will work, and whether when you do bring in additional authorizations, how you do that, what has to be included in the dossiers, and also whether those products still have to be within the horizontal EU regulations or not. That is a really critically important point, because at the moment, from the current list that we can see, some crops such as pineapple could face problems because there are at the moment no uses or substances, for example, for flower induction in organic systems. So I think I've probably completed my 10 minutes, but we will have under the question and answer session opportunity to go into these issues in more detail. In my next slide, it simply lists some of the main regulations that you can look at your leisure. But as I said, there are secondary items still under development that are not yet available. So thank you very much. I'll now hand over back to the moderator and look forward to going into further discussion later in the Q&A session.
Thanks a lot, Morag, and thanks a lot for that list of relevant acts that are still ongoing. And that's linked to another question that was asked to Elena about the process through which stakeholders have been involved, that we're gonna go back in the question and answer. So after having had this perspective from the private sector, now let's move to the other side of this. So let's keep on diving now through the perspective of the Organization of African, Caribbean, and Pacific States. For that, it's a pleasure to have the Assistant Secretary General of the Department of Structural Economic Transformation and Trade of the ACT organization. We are going to hear from Estipion Oliveira on what is the position of ACT organization countries and what are the activities of this organization. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Jorge. For me, it's a very big honor to be here today with our colleagues from the European Commission, from COLACP and from IFOA. I think this is a very important team, and we would like really to exchange with the public, and your ideas are very much welcome. Please pass the slide. For those that do not know us, I am from the Organization of African, Caribbean, and Pacific States, the OECPAs, which became an international organization last year. We evolved from the ACP group that was founded in 1975 through the Georgetown Agreement. We're composed by 79 countries, from Africa, the Caribbean, and the Pacific. And our goal is to promote the sustainable development of our member states and the gradual integration into the global economy with the ultimate objective of reducing and eventually eradicating poverty. In our quest for development, the promotion of youth and women empowerment is at the center of all of our actions. We are led by our Secretary General, His Excellency Mr. George Revelo Pinto Chicote from Angola. Next slide, please. Foundation, the Georgian Agreement in Article 5, we see that we have to promote the efforts of a member state to eradicate poverty and achieve sustainable development and to fully benefit from the advantages of trade through the participation of the world economy. So this type of event is really at the basis of what we tried to do. As it has been said, the European Union has launched the Farm to Fork and Biodiversity Strategies as part of its Green Deal, and we strongly support those new initiatives. However, we believe that we have to address jointly many of the implications of the regulations and rules that will be developed by our partners, particularly the organic one, which Morag has very well explained, because we are afraid that some of these rules that have a very good basis and seek to assist our populations and our people might become insurmountable technical barriers to trade and or non-tariff barriers to our exporters. So the view that I'm gonna give today is while supporting strongly the new developments in promoting organic, promoting better health and new regulations, that they have also to take into consideration the specificities of the partners of the European Union in other countries. In this, I must say that we have an excellent relationship with DigiTrade and DigiIMPA, and that I'm sure that through dialogue and joint collaboration, we will achieve this. So next slide, please. I would just like to go over with you some of the issues that affect market access for the agricultural produces of our countries. They have to do with production and productivity. Sometimes it's not easy for our countries to have the enough resources, financial resources and others to achieve certain production to be competitive. We do promote with the European Commission, and it's a big part of the COCO talks that are actually being promoted by DG Agri, the idea of living income for farming, because this is essential to attain sustainable development. And we're very happy that the European Commission is strongly supporting this. And also price volatility is one of the issues affecting especially commodity exporters that we have to tackle. The sustainability agenda, also something that we are engaged in discussion in climate change, deforestation, and child labor. We also are working towards this, the new regulations that we will be dealing today, especially the organic one, but also new regulations on the use of pesticides are also, or have the possibility of becoming also barriers to trade. For the specific relationship of us with the European Union, the Brexit and the rules of origin is an issue. And I wanted to reassure every member here, every person participating that the OCPS and all of our members, we are committed to the global sustainability agenda in the pursuit of the sustainable development goals. Next slide, please. What is the strategy that we're pursuing under the leadership of Secretary General Chicote? With the partners in the European Commission, also working with Cole ACP, Morag, and Jeremy and their team, we try to ensure that OECPS exporters and farmers maintain a competitive access to the European Union market. When I talk about competitive market, some of the issues I raised with regards to Brexit, what are the rules of origin that are being applied, but with specifically with regards to organic is compliance. And there, we have also to ensure that our farmers and exporters have sufficient time and resources to adapt their production to the ever-evolving regulations. In this, I must say that to react as a group, but once we really got the ball running, we have been harnessing a lot of interest and a lot of debate. We also have to ensure that our stakeholders can participate with the European Commission and other partners in the development of new regulations. This is part of the recently signed OACPS EU New Partnership Agreement that talks about being able to contribute to the development of new rules. We work with our partners in the European Commission to ensure that we have an exchange of best practice and cooperation. As you have seen, we have countries like the Dominican Republic, which is a major exporter of organic product. We also would like to share the experiences of the Dominican Republic with other producers in Africa and the Pacific and throughout the Caribbean. And we also want to take the necessary actions upstream to ensure that new rules and regulations that might be put in place by the European Union or other partners do not have a negative impact in the export of our countries. In this regards, one of the things that we're really working towards and based in the experience.
Basado en la experiencia.
Yes, I think I'm hearing Spanish. Okay, so based on this experience, we are working with the European Commission to establish an early warning mechanism to trade. Next slide, please. This is something that we're working with the European Commission, and it's based in work that has already been done by our partners from COLACP, which Morag is representing here today. We have together with the European Union worked.
¿Me escuchan?
Excuse me. Yo le escucho a usted en live, no en español.
Interpretation is going into a channel of English.
Okay, there's a problem then. We're going to sort that out.
So I'm listening myself in Spanish. Maya, just speak in Spanish. For those that didn't notice, English is not my first language. So this early warning mechanism with which we're working with the European Commission will see us working together with DG Agri, DG Sanco, DG Trade, and DG INPA in order to be able to detect upstream new rules and regulations. And like I said, it's based on good work done by COLACP with the Fit for Market Sanitary and Phytosanitary Initiative, which has been very successful in the areas of fruit and vegetables. And they have been successful because they have fostered the collaboration of public and private stakeholders. And this sort of debate organized today by Fair Trade is the type of examples that we are really trying to pursue. This mechanism that we are putting in place is also based on work done by the International Trade Center, ITC. As if you go to the web page, you'll see that they have a lot of market access tools, such as the market access map, the export protection map, the sustainability map, and the trade competitiveness map. The idea is to work together with our partners to join these initiatives together into something that will allow us to detect and consult our stakeholders with a view of being able to participate in the development of new rules. At first stage, this platform will be concentrated in 11 value chains. It doesn't mean that they are the only value chains that will be working, but they have been considered as a priority by our member states. They are cashew, livestock, maize, cotton, coconut, rum, cocoa, coffee, cava, sugar, and cassava. These 11 products are of the utmost importance and cover all of our countries. As you would see, for example, cava is a staple that is very, very, very important to the Pacific, and we're covering it, while the other ones are shared throughout the OACPs. And next slide, please. And just one, if you can go back one slide, just to, here you will see the photographs that we show there is how we want to add value to cotton value chain. In fact, here you see events that the OACPs have sponsored with the European Union in fashion and having local designers work with fabric events that have happened in Dominican Republic and Kenya. It's just for the photographs. So next step, please. So what do we want this mechanism to do is to closely monitor, at least at the beginning, EU regulatory process. Hopefully we will also include other countries that will be our target markets. We want to analyze new regulations with a development perspective as to identify possible negative impacts that might hamper the competitiveness of our exporters. We want to ensure that our stakeholders in our countries have the adequate information, and we can disseminate this information with an analysis similar to what Morag was trying to explain just before my presentation. We want also to complement other initiatives. The idea is to add value to our stakeholders, to the private sector in our countries, given that, like I said already, COLACP and ITC have similar platforms. And you can also mention UNCTAD and even the website created by the European Commission to help exporters, the Export Help Desk, which is very also, which is a tool very important for our exporters. The idea is to harness all of this information together and allow a real public-private sector debate between our countries in the developing world and the European Union. We would also like to provide short-term technical assistance to our farmers in our countries at a national, regional level in a case-by-case basis to promote the conformity. This will be done through various programs. Nowadays, the European Union and the OECD are implementing a private sector development strategy covering many issues. And one of the main issues we're working on is quality of our products to ensure that we can export quality, but also to ensure that our consumers at home also have the best quality at their hands. Like I explained, the idea is that these new rules, we strongly support the new rules, but we need time, resources to be able to implement them. And we also would like to have a seat at the table to be able to discuss them and ensure that these new rules actually do not become these barriers. And next slide, please. Just to end, I would like to say that the work that we're doing together with our partners starts at a national level, building competitiveness, building also a good regional market, working towards continental markets, especially the African Free Trade Area. We hope to have ACP-wide transfer of knowledge with our partners, and hopefully together, we will conquer the world with our best quality products. Next slide. I just wanted to end by saying gracias, thank you, merci, merci, obrigado, thank you, danke, danke, shokran, jarejef, asante, binaka, and amese ginalehu. Thanks a lot for your time. I'm looking forward to your questions. And I am really delighted by the invitation for Freight Trade to be here today at your service in Brussels and under the leadership of our Secretary General. Thank you very much.
Asante, Stefan, for this very, very good presentation. It's been a pleasure to hear you, and always good to have your collaboration in Brussels. So to finish this this deep dive in the regulation, to go all the way to the seabed of it, let's go to getting some guidance on what to do and how to adapt to this. For that, no one better than Michel Reynaud, who works is a board member of IFOAM Organics Europe, and he's also vice president of ECOCERT. So he's an expert on regulation and has also experience in auditing and in auditing techniques. And he has actually worked in a consultant already in previous organic regulation. So he'll be the best place to guide us on exactly how to adapt, to which Mora has already done some introduction. Michel, do you want to show a presentation?
Hey, no presentation. I will try to react on what has been said.
That's perfect.
Okay, try to have an open discussion. First, thank you very much for invitations. IFOAM is thanking you. IFOAM is the Europeans. Umbrella organization for organic food and farming, and we are almost 200 members and in 34 European countries. It's very challenging today, and I think the title is very challenging and interesting, is how can African farmers prepare for the changes? And it was interesting also exercise for me, because mostly we have a look on the regulation, and especially for the new regulations, we try to identify it, or where are the problems. And my task today is maybe to say, instead, where are the problems, to see where are the solutions, and try to see, you know, the problems you identified in the process of building up this regulation. But I think once the regulation is there, we must concentrate on what are the solutions. And my role today maybe will be a little bit to demystify or identify potential solutions in several problematics. I will try to do this exercise. with PIC under the control of Helena, and we will try to see practical solutions, and maybe we see some fears, and maybe there's also some solution when we read closely the regulations. It offers also a solutions. I will tackle some aspect of the new regulations. Will be the one which is we concern also a lot of people is the legal personality. The second one is the size of a group, and also the organization of the ICS. And the last aspect, which is not linked to the Grover Group, is the substances, but it was already mentioned by Morak. Coming back to the legal personality, you have seen in the different presentations the change. There were two ways in the current regulations or in the third countries to be organized. There was farmers associations in terms of cooperative associations, and there was one organized under the umbrella of exporters, traders, or processors. And the second one would not be possible anymore, and it means that the farmers who were organized under this must establish legal personality, and that's the reason I really invite, and I think it's very broader, because it's when we speak about legal personality, it's really the one in the third country, so you have to see the most adapted with less burdens, the administrative burdens you can have to set up this. And I think it's you have to start as quick as fast as possible. And that I think there's in each country a solution on this. And this move to processors, traders, organized group, to the self-organized farmers. I think if we read even in the organization of the ICS, you can also in some way to continue in terms of means. It means the regulations does not say that the processors and traders or exporters can help in terms of means, the group to have enough means to be self-organized. The way the regulation is there is always in the view of certifications of the farmers. And if there are some supports to be able to set up an ICS or to put some means, it could be also technicians and so on, which is very important in the regulations. And I think it's a way also of empowerment of the farmers' organizations, is that they have the decisions independently to the processors and to the traders. But as said, as far as my reading of the regulations, there's no, it's not forbidden that processors and traders can help on financial aspect, but also on technical aspects. But decision making will be at the farmers group levels. It is foreseen that we will have ICS as internal control system managers and also internal inspectors. It's clear that these two functions are different, and one person cannot have these two functions there. And we have also the problem we can meet is due to the, I will say, the reduction of the size of the group, which is 2,000 members. In some maybe commodities or some areas or in some regions, it could be problematic to have enough means, because it costs to establish the ICS and so on. But nobody has said, so far as I understood also regulation, you can also mutualize. It does not mean that an ICS manager can work for two groups and in order to mutualize also maybe some costs, but which is clear in terms of certification, decision making, each group will have to organize himself. So I think there are practical solutions that we can develop or to see there. And And I think it's also when we read careful the regulations, it's mean also that I think the intentions of these regulations is not to put problem, but try to increase the credibility of the systems. I think Elena mentioned already also the problem met in some countries or in some group certifications, and the will, I am sure the Commission was also to try to make clear rules which are much more detailed than the one existing today in the in the guidelines, and which will be applied in the EU and also outside the EU. When I come to the ICS again, and it does not mean that also all the staff can be employed. You can also outsource some issues in terms of inspectors. It could be also an organism a little bit specialized to do the internal inspections, and it can make sometimes sense to that these inspectors can work for different groups. So there are many issues, and my first recommendations would be have a look how your group is organized, actually organized in the current regulations. Have a look on the requirements and try to see how far it does match or not match, and what are the change you have to do. And you will see, and also to step by step that you validate this with certification bodies, because at the end they will certify the group, and you must make it sure that your group and the way you organize your group, your control system, internal control system, is conform to the requirement of the regulations. Concerning the size of a group, it's clear there's a big change. Elena mentioned already, there was also many groups, or some groups with a high number of members. And it was also seen that it's clear more you are a high number of members, I would say, difficult it is to when you come to decertifications because the impact is bigger. And if we have a look on this, let's see also as an opportunity for the group in terms also of risk management. If you divide it in, let's say, 10,000 farms in five groups of 2,000, when a group is not working well, then is, you know, all the group which is decertified, and then you have still 8,000 farmers maybe not concerned because the other group works well. If you put into one and it does not work well, it 10,000 farmers were decertified. So I think it's we see the problem sometimes of means, and also this legal personality could be a little bit an impact, but on the other side, it's also in terms of risk management to see this as an opportunity, to take this also as an opportunity, as far as you can mutualize some maybe cost or staff. One also, you know, the Commission has also foreseen, or the regulation has foreseen also a transition period for the existing group to this. And I will also recommend to the existing group, which has also a huge number of farmers already, to make some clusters of maximum 2,000 in order to also already organize, and then you can come to your legal entity. But first, organize yourself for this, because I think it's also this opportunity to reduce the risk, and this opportunity also to see how it works. And I will say, let's have on the second step the setup of a legal personality. But I will recommend this, because I think it's a good opportunity also to manage the system, and in order to have also the certification for this group for the purpose of certifications. What I will also say is one point in terms of your group as to manage these internal control systems, and you will have to identify all the non-conformity and also the sanction you take. And I also will recommend that you work very closely with your certification body, because your certification body will also have a non-conformity catalog or the sanction catalog. And I think it's good to have an adequation, because and you have the same understanding on the non-conformity on the sanction as to be taken if you have to withdraw a member, or if you have to take some decision, but it is taken at the same level as your certification body. And maybe the last point I will mention is concerning the substances, but it was already discussed, and I think it's still a critical issue. I think there are ways, I also here recommend to identify it when you see the list on the different annexes on other regulations. And if you identify some substances, that you start to make a dossier. The rules are not finalized already to see whom will carry the request to the commission. It seems it's foreseen first that it is the certification bodies, but we will like also, and in the discussion we have with the commissions, to try to extend also to maybe other organizations, because it could be also some burden or some you can have in different countries, and each one would have to ask, and maybe we can also find ways. But this is discussion we have with commission to make as smooth as possible the way to do it. But already you have to prepare to add some substances, and that you start to work on a dossier while you're doing this, and so on. As soon you do it, soon you will get it in in the list if it's recognized, and you will be able to use it, as far as we have a transition between the equivalency and the conformity. Yes, it will be my input on this, and what I want to say is, as a conclusion, it's very important to keep this dialogue. This dialogue already exists with the organization and the commission to try to find the way and the practical solutions. The text is there, so we have to implement it. And also, a second level of dialogue is the one between the farmers and their certification bodies, in order to prepare also and the different steps the organization and the practices. So I give you the floor back to you, George. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Michel, for this very clear and pragmatic presentation. So well, you end up speaking about dialogues, and in that note, I'm going to first look to Elena, because I think that in several moments we have talked about the public consultations, but perhaps you could expand a little bit more on how producers and stakeholders are involved in the review of the new regulations. And then, since we have limited time, I'm going to put it together with another technical questions that I have read in the chat box. Authorizations to use substances in third countries, will this have to be authorized under the horizontal EU regulations, or simply in accordance to a regulation 396/2005?
Okay, so first of all, may I? Yeah. First of all, I would like really to thank, all the speakers, and in particular also, I really appreciated the presentation of Michel Reynaud, which finally goes into giving solution and seeing the opportunity out of this regulation. So just to, before going to the questions, I would like just to recap a bit on what I've heard from the CODASEP. I mean, these are all fears that have been already elaborated a lot with with the sector. First of all, just to make sure that everybody has a clear understanding, the equivalence of the national with the national rules will remain. Of course, it will be transformed into a fully fledged trade agreement, for which I frankly think there will be much more clarity than an exchange of letters, for which I bet anyone finding what is the document of reference that is applied in the third country. So higher transparency instead of a lower transparency. What it is related to the difference of standards, and it looks like the compliance is going to kill organics in third countries, that is not true at all, because when we did the impact assessment before preparing, and as I said already in my presentation, the standards applied in third countries and in the EU are very similar for what are the plant production concerned. The only differences that were detected as a significant one were was the retroactive recognition of land in third countries. So what was the condition to give a retroactive recognition and the use of non-organic seeds. Not really that big revolution if we go to the compliance. Then about the group of operators, which is the crucial point of this debate. Well, what we ask is to limit the group to 2000, which as was rightly pointed out by Michelle, it gives opportunities rather than problems. The fact that traders will not hold the certificate, doesn't mean that the trader cannot trade the products. I mean, this is just a matter to give back the context of a group of operators to farmers. And the certificate has to be held by farmers, not by a trader that decides the good and the bad of the group. Then 5% of inspection from external certification body means that in operators group, operators don't really mean that it's going to increase the burden. Let's try to do some math and to do a bit of a reasonable consideration about the group. If you think that to individual operators, we ask a control every year, here we're talking about a control every 20 years. So I would like to see where the burden is. And the 2% of sampling means 40 samples. Said this, the geographical distance has not been defined. So it's very open to any geographical you want to consider on that. So now, as Michelle has said, let's build on this. That's the time of complaining about this is over. And now we have to see where are the opportunities. Going to the questions, the consultation was broad. We had for the preparation of the Basic Act, we had first the broad public consultation organization, and there it was the first phase. As it was rightly said, after 4 years we got to the Basic Act, it was voted by the Council and the Parliament, and we started producing the secondary legislation. And every single act of the secondary legislation has been negotiated together with our member states, which are normally receiving all the inputs from the different stakeholders in their country. And all the texts have been put for public consultation for 30 days and for TBT consultation for 60 days in order to give to third countries the possibility to react. And then it was wrapped up, summed up, reported to the member states and commented to the third countries if necessary. When it comes to the substances, it's clear it will follow the same authorization that is used for the products and substances which are used in the EU. So there is an article which says that a dossier has to be presented. It will have to be assessed by our scientific committee, which is made up of external scientists, and then it will be added into the list of the substances that will be used into the organic sector. So this was one of the questions, and do you have others for me?
No, I think that was very clear. Thanks a lot, Elena. Since we are limited on time, I'm going to now turn to Moray for one question and ask you to try to reply in 2 minutes so that then we have two more minutes for the other two speakers. So I would be very interested to know how is the EU regulation enough to cover the cost related to organic production?
Well, it's a very interesting question, but really the cost and pricing for is something that falls outside of the scope of regulation. It's a commercial discussion. But in terms of the reality of producers, very often they're being asked to do more and more. It's sustainability obviously goes beyond the organic sector now, and also even under conventional production, there are more requirements in certification schemes, et cetera, to demonstrate good environmental and good social practice. And as consumers, you know, we should be paying for this, but the reality is that we're often not, and the prices are not necessarily going up in a corresponding way to cover the increased costs of production that is being put. And so I think the banana sector is a very good one, and in demonstrating this, and I know that there are some producer organizations in Latin America have been very vocal in actually trying to get some more open discussion on the challenges they face as producers in trying to meet these growing requirements without being able to get any increase in price and reflection. But it will be an issue for the organic sector potentially going forward if there's going to be a real push for increase and growth in demand, because it will then be pushing organic into consumer sectors that are no longer niche but more mainstream, and which will require, you know, a corresponding increase in the price they're willing to pay. So I hope that covers the question, but it is a very interesting topic.
Thank you. Yeah, this is also a question that is very close to the topic that Fairtrade works on, and something that we as FTO have been working in the context of the Unfair Trading Practices Directive, which is pretty much linked to this issue. So now the rest of the questions, I don't know if who wants to deal with each of them. I would be very interested to know more about reframing the question a little bit about the ethylene for flour induction. Perhaps Michelle, you could spend a little bit on this issue, not so much on how the EU wants to approach it, but what are the possibilities there?
Ethylene is an issue since 20 years in organic and with different aspects, because we always had it was a calcium carbide first, and then we have to withdraw from the equivalency standards. Then was the use of ethylene, but also in the horizontal legislations, the criteria for use have also changed. It was for just until recently, the possibility to use also ethylene outdoor. Now it's limited to indoor, and it's really a problem, especially in Africa. But they do not use also ethylene directly. They use also with active charcoal. So it means we need really a discussion and with the commission, and I think I really invited also the farmers organization, but I think CoLACP, but we should also work with some research institute like CIRAD. I can remember for I think it was 20 years ago where the problem already appears, and and it was not the authorization was for import was given by the member state. We are really discussion and try to find solution on there, and I'm sure there's a will from both sides to find a solution, and we need to set up a dossier with carbon coal which is enriched with ethylene, and to see if it's acceptable, because the principles are there, and this outdoor and indoor, it's clear within the EU. What I want to say also is these substances, it's very interesting. It's not only for the third countries, it's also for outmost region of of the EU, like Martinique, Guadeloupe, Réunion, or other parts. And I think there's, in terms of harmonization and to avoid unfair competition. And I will really push that these organizations of the third country, but also these regions, work together to make it possible to use this ethylene for the flooring induction. Otherwise, it will be really a problem in the pineapple productions, and to see where the solutions are. But I think technical dossier, and always I think it's very important to come also with really some scientific or from CIRAD is able also probably to help also the sectors, and then to come to the commission and to say, yes, we have something. And there's this scientific, this ECTOP will be all study this and to see if there's a solution, try to find the solution. But Elena probably will say also something on this. But I think the will is to always to find solutions and from both sides. And I think we should work on it and try to come with very substantial informations and documentation.
Thank you, Michel. So I'm now giving the floor to Estipia, who I believe wants to expand on this.
Yeah, I wanted to say basically that this is a major issue for the pineapple production in Dominican Republic, and that we will be assisting the Dominican embassy and producers, which have contacted us. And I believe they are engaging with the European Commission on this, because as Michelle has explained, it is an issue for the pineapple. So I believe the spirit of this discussion here today is basically collaborate in the setting of these rules. And I think that Michelle basically explained very well. But I just wanted to the OCPS secretariat has been by the organic pineapple producers from Dominican Republic, and that we have always. With regards to the other questions, I thought that there were questions about the cost. Of course, there is a cost associated with every type of production. The idea is that we're really trying to ensure that our countries have the necessary time and resources. Some of the resources, will we have enough resources for everybody? Not necessarily, but the idea is to work together and possibly also establish funds for the sort. The question is, for me is not really if, it's when. Rules are coming in. Those rules help the environment, help the consumer. That we're discussing is the time to be able to implement those. Sometimes the time that in general, the European Union has are based on their own experience, which is a faster reaction, but definitely it takes more time. So this is one of the things that we're asking, is time to be able to adapt. Sometimes maybe a 2-year period for the European Union might be reasonable, or for our countries could be 3 or 4. So this is the discussions that we're trying to engage in. So thank you very much.
I'm sorry, I've lost the connection in the last minute. So I understand that you had just finished speaking. Very sorry about that. And I just come back to the stable connection in time to say asante to all of you. It's been really a very insightful discussion. I think that we have a all said in one way or another that the point at now, from now on is to see how to make it work, see how to adapt to the new rules and cooperate smoothly the following. So thanks again. Keep on enjoying this very very important and timely convention, and have a very good afternoon.
Muchas gracias.
Merci.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.